Yeah, so if one of my friends asks me to make something, I'll probably go ahead and do it. My name's Corbin Dunn, and in this video, I'm gonna walk through the creating of this wok spatula on my CNC machine. And I wanted this to be a very simple project that you guys could make at home on your own CNC machine, so I went ahead and created two versions of the files. The original design is done in Autodesk Fusion, and I did all my CAD and CAM there. And then went ahead and redid it in Vectric VCarve, because I know a lot of people like to use VCarve. So I'll have files available for this project. You can go ahead and download them. The link will be in the description. Now, if you guys are a woodworker like me, then you're probably hoarding a ton of scraps. And so for this particular project, on the last one I made, I decided to grab a piece of cherry, two pieces of cherry, and a piece of walnut, just to make something a little bit more interesting. Now, a lot of my other spatulas and utensils, I tend to make out of one solid piece, and I designed the shape to be made out of 6/4 wood, which usually when you go buy it from a lumber store, 6/4 rough sawn size translates to about 1.25 or 1¼ inches thick. And that's a great size for this particular project. And if you do make it from a solid piece, you can do a cool inlay like this. However, the inlays are only set up in the Fusion version of the file. I decided not to set it up in VCarve just because it's more difficult. So I used double-sided tape to hold down a chunk of cherry on my CNC spoil board. And I'm using dogs to locate it. I have this saved as an offset, and that way I don't even have to touch off my X and Y, or even my Z because I have an automatic tool changer. I used a 3/8 inch upcut bit to do the cuts here, and this is just a profile cut. I only selected one particular edge in Fusion to actually do it. I realized I might hit my dog, so I removed that while I started cutting. Now this is an incredibly basic 2D shape that I'm cutting out. There's nothing fancy about it, and it's super easy to do. I used some 3D printed clamp stands to hold my clamps up. They're based on the felt house design, and I just modified it to suit my needs. They work pretty well. You can download a copy. I'll link to them. To start this project, you have to create a stock piece. And the most important thing when doing two-sided machining is the thickness of the stock. It really needs to be dead on thick. In this case, it's a 1.25 inches. And if it's a little bit thicker, your piece is gonna turn out to be thin. On the other hand, if it's a little bit thinner, your piece will actually turn out to be a little bit thicker. So err on the size of cutting it a little bit smaller or really dead on, and use your CNC to machine it if your planer isn't very accurate. Okay, I don't want to cut into my spool board a lot, and we need to have alignment holes to do the two-side operation. At least that's the easiest way to do it. So I made a temporary spool board, just a piece of MDF. Cut about the same size as my piece, it's the same width. So I go ahead and I clamp the temporary spoil board down my table. I like to use dogs to locate it, and that way I can remove it and put it back down and locate it in again. Now I use a 1/4 inch drill bit to drill the alignment holes. If you don't have a drill bit or a CNC that can go low enough in the RPMs for a drill bit, then you're gonna probably have to use a 1/4 inch upcut bit. You do not wanna use a downcut bit to do holes. I'm using 3D printed toe clamps that I designed with removable tips, and these are 2-inch tips which work great to hold this stock down really well. The origin for the top operation doesn't have to be very precise. You can kind of roughly align it by eye, and that's because you're gonna be drilling alignment holes that will precisely locate it for the bottom operation. I've been doing pretty shallow passes with a 1/4 inch upcut bit, and I really think I could actually do more aggressive machining, but this seems to work pretty well and avoids a lot of chip out. 3D adaptive inside of Fusion will give a lot more chip out, and even though it's faster, I tend to do pocket clearing. The finishing operation was done with an 1/8 inch ball nose, and I like to go perpendicular in passes to the grain. I think it gives less chip out. I don't know. If you guys have any opinions, let me know down below. That upcut bit will sometimes leave fuzzy parts on the top of the workpiece, and you don't want these to stick up and affect the thickness of the piece when you do the bottom side, so I will trim them off. I've also gone to using a 1/4 inch downcut bit to do my roughing because it's so shallow with my passes, and that way I don't have to actually do that cleanup step. So I put some quarter inch wood dowels into the piece to locate the bottom, and I cut my holes a little bit too shallow in the actual VCarve file that I'll be sharing with you guys. I made them deeper. And if you don't get them seated all the way, you can see the problem here. The workpiece is rocky, it's not sitting flat, and you really want to make sure it sits flat, nothing underneath making it stick up. So I just grabbed some shorter dowels in this particular case, and that worked fine. Now, while you watch me do the next few steps, I'm going to talk a little bit more about the design. I originally did my spatula and utensil designs in Blender, which is a 3D mesh program. And the problem with mesh designs, you really have to manipulate a lot of points and edges, and particularly work with a defined resolution, which really isn't that fun. Something that's more specific and controllable are surfaces. And so I remodeled this in Autodesk Fusion doing surface modeling, and that gives me nice, tight surfaces that I can really manipulate and precisely control the curves. And along with that, I could actually do all the CAD and, the toolpaths, the CAM inside of Fusion directly, and things will just work a little bit better as opposed to using a 3D mesh model. Now, for Vectric VCarve, I exported the model from Fusion as an STL, which is a 3D mesh, imported that into Vectric VCarve, and create all the toolpaths there to do the cutting. And I have a video, I think I'll link to it as a private video or just an unlisted video about how I did all the setup inside of Vectric VCarve. It took about 15 or 20 minutes to walk through. And if you want to watch me setting it up in VCarve, importing it, setting some limit planes, you can go ahead and watch that video. If you're curious about what I was doing earlier, where I was spraying it with something, that's just water. You want to always sand to 220, raise the grain with some water, letting it dry off, and sand it again with 220. And that way your utensils won't be fuzzy after the first time you wash them. And I'm just using a cutting board oil to add a finish to this. So the hardest part of a project like this is the design. It takes a lot of skill and knowledge to be able to manipulate shapes and create a 3D model for what you want to actually physically make. And that's what modern woodworking is. You're digitally sculpting things and then using a machine to cut it out. It's still woodworking. It's just a different type of woodworking. So I spend a lot of time on the design of this shape, making it feel right in your hand. And I also spent a lot of time just redoing all the toolpaths inside of Vectric VCarve, because I know you guys might want to go ahead and make this and not have to set it up for yourselves. So feel free to go ahead and buy a copy of the plans. I'll put a link to them. I'll have a PDF with the directions, which also took me several days to write up. And that way you can follow some steps and hopefully have good success with making a project like this. The inlay is actually a little bit more difficult, and like I said before, it requires Fusion. I could do it in VCarve. If you do want to see videos on how to actually set up an inlay in VCarve that's curved, let me know. Maybe I can get around to doing that at some point. Anyways, thanks everyone.